بدأت ببسم الله في النظم أولا تبارك رحمن الرحيما وموئلا وثنيت صلى الله ربي على الرضا محمد المهدى إلى الناس مرسالا وعترته ثم الصحابة ثم من تلاهم على الإحسان بالخير وبالا.
If a ruler, you know, drinks khamar, you know, does all sorts of fawahish, even performs the actions of Qawm Lut. And if you've got such a ruler like that, he's not fit for power. And if you've got the ability to remove him, get rid of him. Simple. Get rid of him. If there was a leader exactly like Walid bin Yazid bin Abdul Malik, and we have the ability to remove him, we get rid of him. Simple. He's not fit for power. He should not be even, you know, we should not even allow such people to stay in power. He should be removed. So if there's a leader such like that, they should be, the ulama should get together and encourage people to get rid of this and topple this freak, you know, who's committing all sorts of fawahish, you know, disobeying Allah Azza wa Jal. It says that this is the chosen view, you know, this is the chosen view, that the Imam should be virtuous, a scholar, muhsin qawiyan, very righteous and good and strong, and the establishment that is what requires of him of his imamah. That is the preferred choice, okay? And then he says, فَإِلَّمْ يَكُونَ, and if that is not found, okay, if that's not found, all of these qualities are not found, فَإِلَّمْ يَكُونَ فَالصَّبْرُ عَلَى طَاعَةِ إِمَامَ الْجَائِرِ أَوْلَ مِنْ خُرُوجْ عَلَيْهِ. So if you don't find this, it is better to have patience with an imam that is a transgressor, a tyrant, than doing khuruj. Now look at this statement here, which Shamsi, it goes against him. Because if khuruj was mutlaqan haram, Ibn Abdul Bar died 463. If it was mutlaqan haram to do khuruj as they say, then why is Ibn Abdul Bar saying having patience is better, having patience against a tyrant ruler is better than revolting against him? Let's go to Tafsir al-Qurtubi. Tafsir al-Qurtubi, okay? لِقَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى, because of the statement of Allah that my covenant, Allah saying my covenant subhanahu wa ta'ala does not extend to the transgressing people, the oppressors. Allah's covenant does not extend to them. Then what is the next statement? وَلِهَذَا خَرَجَ Ibn Zubayr, and because of that Ibn Zubayr revolted. Husayn bin Ali radiallahu anhum, وَخَرَجَ خِيَارُ الْأَحْلِ الْأَرَاقِ, and the best of Iraq with their scholars revolted against Hajjaj, and the people of Medina rebelled against many Umayyah, and the battle of Harra happened. Then to be fair again, Al-Qurtubi says, look, I don't skip, I'm not like you, you understand? You madakhila jamia, institutionalized waste paper, subservitude, call it what you want. His reality is, you ain't got, you know, two brain cells to think for yourselves, okay? Imam Qurtubi says, وَالَّذِي عَلَيْهِ أَكْثَرُ مِنَ الْعُلَمَاءِ أَنْ صَبَرَ الطَّاعَةِ الْإِمَامِ الْجَائِرِ أَوْلَ مِنْ خُرُوجِ عَلَيْهِ. He says that the majority of the ulama say that it's better to have patience against a tyrant ruler than revolting against him, which we've said. And why is that? Because it creates bloodshed, you know, it replaces security with fear, etc. Ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi splits those who do khuruj into four different categories. And the fourth category, as you can see on screen, qawmun min ahl al-haqqi. And I'm going to read on as well. So, a people that are upon the truth, rebelling, people on truth. And they go out to remove him, li ta'wil al-sa'ikh. They go out to remove him because of a ta'wil that they do with interpretation. So they go out, they're the people of Haqq, but they go out because of a ta'wil that they do. They make an interpretation as to why they go out rebel. It could be dhulm, could be oppression, could be tyranny, it could be that their loved ones are, you know, or the community has been oppressed, the province has been oppressed, they've been killed, they've been slaughtered, like Hajjaj was doing, like Ja'far bin Mansur was doing, like Yazid was doing, and they went out, they made ta'wil. They didn't go against the text, they made a ta'wil, and Imam Qudama al-Maqdisi confessed. فَهَٰؤُلَاءِ بُغَاتْ. They are the Bughat.
Ibn Qudama, in his Kitab Luma, which is the ninth, he said, "As-sam'u wa ta'ah li'a'immati al-muslimina wa umara'i al-mu'minina barrihim wa fajirihim ma lam ya'muru bima'siyatillah fa'innau la ta'ata li'ahadin fi ma'siyatillah wa man waliya al-khilafata wajtama alayhi al-nas wa radaw bihi aw ghalabahum bisayfihi hatta sara al-khalifata wa summi amira al-mu'minina wajaba ta'atuhu wa harumat mukhalafatu wal-khuruj alayhi wa shaqqu 'asa al-muslimina."
Look how deeply rooted he is in defending oppression and legitimizing religious oppression. Even if you got the ability to, and it will cause less harms, then no, you still can't do it. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, even if the ruler is oppressive. Look at this. Look how much he's drowning and how deep he is in his... to the main part, okay, which Abdurrahman Hassan quoted. So as you can see, he mentions here, okay, clearly, and we're not going to distort any of the passage. So he mentions وَأَنْ لَا نُنَازِعَ الْأَمْرَ أَهْلَهُ, that the translation he gave, okay, which I'm going to show you the correct translation, because this guy is an absolute fraud and distorter. I don't know how, like I said before, I wouldn't trust him with a Walker's pack of crisp of mine, never mind my religion. So he mentions, we do not go against the oppressive Muslim ruler. Where is the word oppressive in here? Where is the word oppressive here? Okay, the word oppressive doesn't exist. Okay, that's number one. But we're going to get to the hadith which shows the correct translation. I'm not going to say what it is because I'm going to present it from sunnah.com. And then he presents a hadith which Abdurrahman Hassan did present, which is basically three things which doesn't enter the heart of a Muslim, or hatred does not enter into the heart of the Muslim, which is ikhlasul amal lillah, that doing an action in sincerity for Allah Azza wa Jal, basically the hatred for the rulers, okay, so one should have hatred for the rulers, and the other is adhering to the jama'ah, because basically the call or the da'wah is behind, it's protected, which is behind them. And then it mentions the, what's he called, ayat of Allah Azza wa Jal, which is obey Allah and obey his messenger and those in authority. Okay, so that's what Imam Bukhari presents. And then he mentioned, then Abdurrahman Hassan presents this passage, which mentions that we do not see the sword upon the ummah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And again, we'll comment on that. So there you go, we got Sharh Usul al-I'tiqad by Imam al-Lalakai. And then he mentions al-Khawarij. You see, when you place it into context, and obviously he mentions thereafter that we do not relinquish or dispute with those in power, because the Khawarij used to make takfir of them and then rebel against them. You see, that was prominent. That's what they were, consistently doing. This was their manhaj. This was their aqidah. So we were countering that because we do not dispute with those in power. And obviously those in power, meaning the righteous ruler, the ruler of justice, the righteous ruler, the ruler of justice, the righteous ruler, the ruler of justice.
وثلثت أن الحمد لله دائما وما ليس مبدوءا به أجدم العالى وبعد فحبل الله فينا كتابوه فجاهد به حبل العدا متحبيلا وأخلق به إذ ليس يخلق جداتا جديدا مواليه على الجد مقبيلا وقارئه المرضي قر مثالوه كالأترج حاليه مريحا وموكيلا هو المرتضى أمان إذا كان أماتا ويممه ذل الرزانة قنقالا هو الحر إن كان الحري حواريا له بتحريه إلى أن تنبالا وإن كتاب الله أوثق شافع وأغنى غناء واهبا متفضيلا وخير جليس لا يمل حديثه وتردده يزداد فيه تجملا وحيث الفتى يرتاع في ظلماته من القبر يلقاه سنم متهللا هنالك يهنيه مقيلا وروضاتا ومن أجله في ذروة العز يجتالا يناشد في إرضائه لحديث.
Let's go back to Shurul Usul al-I'tiqad, and I'm going to present context now, because when they present these passages they add their own spin and try to force their own deviant methodology, i.e. this neo-Salafi rhetoric, into these passages. What we're presenting is that when you present all of these passages from the books of the Salaf, etc., understand this context. Do not, misquote and not misapply and misrepresent the books of the Salaf to then forge your plastic.
فيا أيها القاري به متمسكا مجلا له.
أحمد بن نصر الخزاعي stood up, okay? He stood up and he called the people to enjoin the good and forbid the evil. Against who? The ruler. Because remember, this is about Khalq al-Quran. Even though they oppressed as well. But this is talking about specifically Khalq al-Quran, the Quran being created. And he called the people to much good. Then a jama'at gathered with him from the people of Baghdad, and thousands of people joined him. Okay? Thousands. Thousands. So, فَلَمَّا كَانَ شَحْرُ شَعْبَانَ مِنْ هَذِهِ السَّنَةِ. He said, in this particular, in Sha'ban, in this particular year, the people got together with Ahmad bin Nasr al-Khuza'i and gave him bay'ah. Look at that, gave him bay'ah. Okay? For what? فِي السِّرِّ عَلَى الْقِيَامِ بِالْأَمْرِ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَالنَّحِي عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. He says that they gave him bay'ah to enjoin the good. Okay? And forbid the evil. And he called to rebelling, doing khuruj against the Sultan due to his bid'ah. And his claim that the Quran is
correct. فما ظنكم بالناجل عند جزائه أولئك أهل الله والصفوة المالى أولو البر والإحسان والصبر والتقى حلاهم بها جاء القرآن مفصلا عليك بها ما عشت فيها منافسا وبنفسك الدنيا بأنفسها العلا.
And therefore this is a mursal narration, it's disconnected, and we know that obviously if it's disconnected it can't be used as evidence.
That Imam Malik, as you can see, it's highlighted in yellow, you can't hide it, that Imam Malik gave a fatwa to rebel with Muhammad bin Nafs al-Zakiyya. Okay, quite clearly you can see.
look, Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah said something. He said, well, Husayn radiyallahu ta'ala anhu ma kharaja yuridu al-qital. Husayn did not go to fight. Walakin dhanna, what he thought was, anna an-nasa yuti'unahu, that the people were going to obey him. But he didn't know the reality of people of Kufa. They lied and deceived him. Yuti'unahu. Falamma ra'a insirafahum anhu. But when Husayn came to that place and found out there was nothing there, what did he realize now? That the thing that he was mistaken on now became clear to him, which is Yazid had power over everyone. He now realized that. Now he believes, I have to give bay'ah.
And that's why he gave the theory.
That's why he said to, I want to go to Yazid. I'll speak to Yazid. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah said, وَأَحَادِيثُ النَّبِي صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَلَّتِي يَأْمُرُ فِيهَا بِقِتَالِ الْمُفَارَقَةِ لِلْجَمَاعَةِ لَمْ تَتَنَاوَلْهُ. The hadith which we hear the Prophet saying, anyone who cuts the unity of the Muslims, شَقَّ عَسَى الْمُسْلِمِينَ, to cut the Muslim breaks the Muslim unity, he says those hadith don't apply on Hussein. Why? فَإِنَّهُ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنُهُ لَمْ يُفَرْخِ الْجَمَاعَةِ. He didn't do tafriqatul jama'ah. Why? وَلَمْ يُقْتَلْ إِلَّا وَهُوَ طَالِبٌ لِلْرُجُوعِ إِلَى بَلَدِهِ. Because Hussein was killed whilst trying to return back to his land. أو إلى الثغري أو إلى يزيدا. He put these three options. Remember I mentioned. Hussein said, I want to go back to my land. Or take me to the border and I'll be a border controller and I'll do that, a police for the Muslim. Or I want to go to Yazid. داخلا في الجماعة. He entered the جماعة. معرضا عن تفرقة الأمة. He turned away from dividing the Muslims. And that was the advice that was given. Ibn Taymiyyah is saying, Hussein now is not in that discussion right now. Why? Because he asked to return back to his land.
Yeah.
He said, I don't want to be part of any of this. So I'm saying, let's say Hussein did Khuruj, according to you guys. He repented. فَكَيْفَ يُحْتَجُّ بِفِعْلٍ نَدِيمَ مِنْهُ. How could we use an action that he regretted? How could we reuse an action that what? He regretted. Now someone might come and say, but Hussein only came back from this after he realized that he hasn't got power. It wasn't his choice. He didn't want to.
He was forced into it. Yeah, that's exactly what I've got here.
So what did he say?
He was coerced into it. He was forced into it. He realized things have gone wrong. I've got no other option now. That's exactly the argument that they bring, which I was going to ask you about later. That's they say the only reason he repented is because he was forced into it. He had no other choice.
And he didn't do it because he felt like it was the right thing.
No, he was stuck with his family. He was in a difficult situation. He's got no choice.
And he didn't have power.
He didn't have power.
Okay, look at a statement Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah says. Look what Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah says. Ibn Taymiyyah responds to this shubha they bring. Rahimahullah. He says, وَكَذَلِكَ الْحُسَيْنِ حُسَيْن رضي الله عنه لَمْ يُقْتَلْ إِلَّا مَظْلُومًا شَهِيدًا. He was killed unjustly. He was killed as a martyr. تَارِكَ لِطَلَبِ الْإِمَارَةِ. He was walking away from this leadership and everything. He didn't want it. طَالِبًا لِلْرُجُوعِ. He wanted to go back. إِمَّا إِلَى بَلَدِهِ أَوْ إِلَى ثَغْرٍ أَوْ إِلَى الْمُتَوَلِّ عَلَى النَّاسِ يَزِيد. Or go to Yazid and give bay'ah to him. Then Hussein did not believe the idea of what? خروج على الحاكم الفاسق. Why? Because he said, I'm going to give him bay'ah now. Okay. وَإِذَا قَالَ الْقَائِلُ. If a sayer says, Ibn Taymiyyah said, إِنَّ عَلِيًّا وَالْحُسَيْنِ, that Ali and Hussein, إِنَّمَا تَرَكَ الْقِتَالَ فِي آخِرِ الْأَمْرِ, that Hussein, he left رضي الله تعالى عنه, the matter at the ending of the stage, لِلْعَجْزِ, because he was unable.
Yeah.
لِأَنَّهُ لَمْ يَكُنْ لَهَا أَنصَارٌ لَهُمَا أَنصَارٌ, because him and his father didn't have anyone to aid them. That's why they left the matter. فَكَانَ فِي الْمُقَاتَلَةِ قَتْلُ النُّفُوسِ بِلَا حُصُولِ الْمَصْلَحَةِ الْمَطْلُوبَةِ. And Hussein felt, okay, that if he fought, that he wouldn't attain the maslaha he's looking for here.
Yeah.
Because he hasn't got the strength. Ibn Taymiyyah says, قِيلَ لَهُ, it will be said to that person. وَهَذَا بِعَيْنِهِ, this is the same reason why the Sharia said don't go against the oppressive Muslim leader. He said, وَهَذَا بِعَيْنِهِ هُوَ الْحِكْمَةُ الَّتِي رَعَاهَا الشَّارِعُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فِي النَّهِي عَنِ الْخُرُوجِ عَلَى الْأُمَرَةِ. What Hussein felt at that moment is what everybody who goes against a leader, an oppressive Muslim leader, will go through.
They've just proven the wisdom of the ruling. That's all they've done.
That's what they did. وَنَدَبَ إِلَى تَرْكِ الْقِتَالِ فِي الْفِتْنَةِ. وَإِنْ كَانَ الْفَاعِلُونَ لِذَلِكَ يَرَوْنَ أَنَّ مَقْصُودَهُمُ الْأَمْرُ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَالنَّهْيِ عَنِ الْمُنكَرِ. Even if the person says, I'm going to call it to good and pray with the evil. كَالَّذِينَ خَرَجُوا عَلَى الْحَرَّةِ وَبِدَيْمِ الْجَمَاجِمِ عَلَى يَزِيدَ وَالْحَجَّاجَ وَغَيْرِهِمَا. Then Ibn Taymiyyah says, لَكِنْ إذا لم يزل المنكر إلا بما هو أنكر منه صار إزالته على هذا الوجه منكرا، وإذا لم يحصل المعروف إلا بمنكر مفسدته أعظم من مصلحة ذلك المعروف كان تحصيل ذلك المعروف على هذا الوجه منكرا. So there's no really way to go about the issue of Husayn. It's very tricky for those people. It's very hard.
Tariq al-Tabari. Okay? In Tariq al-Tabari. Ya ayyuha al-Islam. O people of Islam. Qatiluhum. Fight them. Fight who? Hajjaj. Sha'bi sendis. Oh, hold on. I thought you were supposed to, take him by the hand. Take him behind closed doors and advising privately. Qala Sa'eed Ibn Jubayr. Oof, another tabi. This is not looking good for you, is it? It's not looking good for you. But again, you're institutionalized, so what can I do? Look what Sha'bi says. Sa'eed Ibn Jubayr. Listen to what Sa'eed Ibn Jubayr says. Qatiluhum. And it's underneath, as you can see. And do not think of any sin by fighting them. Don't think that you're getting sin by fighting them. With intention and with certainty.
Abdullah ibn Zubair, he just refused to give bay'ah at the beginning.
He didn't go towards a particular area to become the leader for them.
People and bay'ah, he did none of that. He didn't quote himself at all. He only did it after the death of Muawiyah ibn Yazid ibn Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. ولذلك, that's why Al-Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, the 16th volume, page 99, he says, وَمَذْهَبُ أَهْلِ الْحَقِّ أَنَّ ابْنَ الزُّبَيْرَ كَانَ مَظْلُومًا وأن الحجاج ورفقته كانوا خوارج. يعني كانوا خوارج علي. ابن الزبير, after the time of معاوية بن يزيد بن يعني ابن معاوية بن أبي سفيان, that's when he called himself to the leader and he said, I am the. ابن كثير رحمه الله mentions that in his كتاب البداية والنهاية. He says, ثم هو كان الإمام بعد معاوية بن يزيد لا محالة وهو أرشد من مروان ابن الحكم. He was most fittest for the role. And he got, and he came out forward for, he came out forward after Muawiyah ibn Yazid ibn Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. Marwan tried to huggle with him. Abdullah ibn Zubayr didn't do khuruj. Marwan did khuruj on him, if anything. Naza'ahu ba'd an ijtama'at al-kalimatu alayhi. The people all came together for Abdullah ibn Zubayr.
Okay.
And they all gave him bay'ah. وَقَامَتِ الْبَيْعَةُ لَهُ فِي الْآفَاقِ. All of the corners of the Muslim land was given to him. وَانْتَضَبَ لَهُ الْأَمْرِ. All the matters were organized for him. Ibn Kathir rahimahullah says that in his 12th volume, page 206 in his Kitab al-Bidayah wal-Nihaya. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyya says something. He says, ثُمَّ إِنَّ ابْنَ الزُّبَيْرَ إِنَّ ابْنَ الزُّبَيْرِ. He said, Ibn al-Zubayr, لَمَا جَرَى بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ يَزِيدِ مَا جَرَى مِنَ الْفِتْنَةِ. Fitnah happened between him and Yazid. What was it about? Was it about khuruj? No, it wasn't. Yazid was forcing Abdullah ibn Zubayr to give bay'ah. Abdullah ibn Zubayr was refusing to give bay'ah. Are you there?
Yeah.
And there were people who were of the stance of Abdullah ibn Zubayr from Ahl al-Makkah to al-Hijaz, Medina, all of them that were sympathizers of Ibn Zubayr.
And Ibn Zubayr was also from Ahl al-Khali wal-Aqd.
He was from Ahl al-Khali wal-Aqd. So he's like Husayn, he was refusing to give bay'ah. وَكَانَ إِظْهَارُ طَلَبَ الْأَمْرِ لِنَفْسِي بَعْدَ مَوْتِي يَزِيد. Look what Ibn Taymiyyah is saying. He only called for himself as the leader after Yazid died when his son Muawiyah ibn Yazid took over. فَإِنَّهُ حِينَئِذٍ تَسَمَّى بِأَمِيرِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. That's when he called himself. وَبَايَعَهُ عَامَّةُ أَهْلِ الْأَمْصَارِ إِلَّا أَهْلِ الشَّامِ. Everyone gave bay'ah to him except أهل الشام. Hence why Marwan bin Hakam, that's where he came from. وَلِهَذَا إِنَّمَا تُعَدُّ وِلَايَتُهُ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَوْتِ يَزِيد. وَلِذَلِكَ, after Yazid, if someone asks you who was the leader of the Muslims, you say Abdullah ibn Zubayr. وَأَمَّا فِي حَيَاةِ يَزِيد. But what about the time of Yazid? فإنهم تنع عن مبايعتي. That's what he did. He just said, I'm not going to give you bay'ah. أولا at the beginning. حيه. ثم بدل المبايعة له. And then he said, I want to give you bay'ah. Yazid, even Islamic muarrikhin mentioned, if Yazid just left Abdullah ibn Zubair, just left him, حتى the fitna, يعني, and لا شك that's the case, all of these fitna would have happened. Abdullah ibn Zubair wasn't a threat directly to Yazid. So Yazid wanted to impose it onto him to give him bay'ah. ولذلك ابن تيمية he said حتى when Yazid pushed too far to Abdullah ibn Zubair, first of all Abdullah ibn Zubair said, no, you're not going to take it forcefully out of me. ثم بدل المبايعة له. Okay, then he said, okay, you know what, I'm going to give you bay'ah.
What's the proof that he gave him bay'ah?
Ibn Taymiyya, I mentioned this kalam of Ibn Shaykh al-Sam Taymiyyah. He said, ثم بدل المبايعة له. Abdullah ibn Zubair, after he said, I'm going to give bay'ah. فلم يرضى يزيد إلا بأن يأتيه أسيرا. He said, I'm not, you can't just tell me you're going to give me bay'ah now.
Yazid wasn't pleased with
I need to make an example of you. I need to make an example of you, and everybody needs to see that anyone who does this to me, this is what's going to happen. You put me through all of this, and now you're saying, I'm just going to give you bay'ah. You're going to come to me as a captive. This is when Abdullah ibn Zubayr said, never ever. فَجَرَتْ بَيْنَهُمَا فِتْنَةً. He said, Asli, you're not my Amir. I haven't even given you bay'ah. If you want to fight, fight like a man, I'll fight you. وَأَرْسَلَ إِلَيْهِ مَزِيدُ مَنْ حَاصَرَهُ بِمَكَّةِ. This is when Yazid did the siege. فَمَاتِ يَزِيدُ وَهُوَ مَحْصُورٌ. Yazid passed away where Abdullah ibn Zubayr was under siege. فلما مات يزيد, when Yazid died, بايع ابن زبير طائفة من أهل الشام. Some of the people of Sham said, we give you bay'ah. والعراق وغيرهم. They all came forward and they gave bay'ah to Abdullah ibn Zubayr. Then he took over. Ibn Taymiyyah, he said, وتولى بعد يزيد ابن معاوية ابن يزيد. And he took over after معاوية ابن. And معاوية ابن يزيد was a very good man. ولم تطل أيامه, the days of معاوية ابن يزيد ابن معاوية wasn't too long. بل أقام 40 يوما. Some even said 20 days. Okay. وكان فيه صلاح ابن تيمية said وزهد. He was a worshipper of Allah. ولم يستخلف أحدا. معاوية بن يزيد بن معاوية didn't appoint a person. He died. When he died, there was a vacuum.
Yeah.
But Abdullah ibn Zubayr is still strong. There's a large portion of Sham that still is not run by Abdullah ibn Zubayr. Some scholars even said all of Sham was not under Abdullah ibn Zubayr. At this point, Marwan ibn Hakam came. Marwan ibn Hakam took over Sham. His days were not long. Abdul Malik ibn Marwan took over. As soon as he took over, he made it his mission to send Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi. He said, go to Hijaz, go to Mecca, get Abdullah ibn Zubayr for me. The fight happened. Abdullah ibn Zubayr got killed in the Haram by Hajjaj. This is what happened to Abdullah ibn Zubayr. Now, who did Khuruj?
Marwan
did, and Abdul Malik ibn Marwan did.
Because they went into Mecca, who Abdullah ibn Zubayr had.
They went to his land, they forced him to give.
Let's now expose this institutionalized waste paper. Okay? In my hand is Al-Istithqar. Okay? This is Al-Istithqar by Ibn Abdul Barr. Al-Maliki. وَخَرَجَ خِيَارُ الْأَهْلِ الْإِرَاقِ وَأُلَمَائِهِمْ عَلَى الْحَجَّاجِ. And the best of the people of Iraq and their scholars revolted against Hajjaj.
the rebellion of Ibn al-Ash'ath, Anas ibn Malik supported it. Anas ibn Malik supported the rebellion against the Umayyad dynasty. Are you going to call him, a'udhu billah, non-Sunni?
Anas ibn Malik was the one that funded the Khuruj against al-Hajjaj. Ya ilaha illallah, what the hell's going on here? Anas ibn Malik, do you know about Anas ibn Malik? He funded the, he was for the revolt against al-Hajjaj, Anas ibn Malik. So the Sahaba didn't understand the Hadith. So if it's all about the Hadith, the Sahaba didn't understand it.
Anas ibn Malik, Husayn radiallahu anhu, where Anas said, Nahana kubara'una, our seniors, they prohibited us from what? Min ashabi rasulina. That's what I'm saying, there's ijma' amongst the sahabas. From what? They said, La tasubbu umara'akum, wa la taghushuhum, wa la ta'asuhum, wa attaqullaha wasbiru, fa innal amra qareebun. Anas ibn Malik is saying this, this is advice that was given to us by who? But our seniors.
And he himself is a companion, right?
He's a companion.
Yeah, and he's saying our seniors.
Ibn Abi Asim narrated this in his Sunnah, the second volume, page 488. And Sheikh Al-Albani, rahimahullah, authenticated it in that kitab, Dhilalul Jannah. He has a kitab on it. He authenticated it. Rahimahullah, Sheikh Al-Albani, rahimahullah ta'ala. So he's saying, لا تصبوا أمراءكم, don't insult your leaders. And this is saying that our seniors, this is what they said to us. وَلَا تَغُشُّوهُمْ, don't deceive them. وَلَا تَعْصُوهُمْ, don't disobey them. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ فِرَ اللَّهِ and wasbiru, be patient regarding their affairs. فَإِنَّ الْأَمْرَ قَرِيبٌ. So these are the senior sahabas who spoke about this issue. A sahabi might sometimes go against a issue which is واضح الدلالة. I'm a واضح الدلالة. A mas'ala that is known, clear. A matter which is a nas, the sahabi might go against it. Or a matter that is even known out of, in Islam, out of, it's known out of necessity. يعني معلوم من الدين بالضرورة. It could happen, a sahabi might go against it. متأولاً. With a ta'wil. An interpretation that he sees. And that does not in any way, shape or form put that sahabi down. Let's take an example.
Does it mean there's a difference of opinion though?
I'm going to come to it.
Okay.
Because when I give the example, the person will say, oh.
Okay, fine.
We have a noble companion by the name of Qudamah ibn Mad'un. Qudamah ibn Mad'un is a Badriyun, and he participated in the Battle of Badr. You already know, right, the reward of the people of Badr.
Yes.
And not only that, I'm going to mention three things about him. He's, first of all, Qudamah ibn Mad'un, he's min al-sabiqeen ila al-Islam. He's from the early people who entered Islam. So he's, yani, there's virtue of the people of Sahabas. There's two types. There are people who are known as those who took Islam min qabli al-fath wa qatal. Ulaika a'zamu darajatan. Allah mentioned they got the higher reward. So he's min sabiqeen, early people who took Islam. Not only that, he participated in the Battle of Badr. Not only that, he participated in the Battle of Uhud. And he's got a high station. And you find this when you hear this name, Fulan ibn Fulan al-Badri. It became a title given to the person. Because Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, you know what he said to the people of Badr? He said, do what you wish. Do what you wish. Wow. Allah has forgiven you. That's what he said to the people of Badr.
That's the status that they
had. The station that they had. Qudamah ibn Mad'un radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he drank alcohol muta'awilan. He brought evidence for it.
He believed it was permissible.
He brought I wouldn't use that word, okay. Istihlal, but what I would say, and I specifically just said, is that he drank alcohol muta'awilan.
Uh-huh, okay.
He drank alcohol with ta'wil. And this is, everybody who's watching now would say alcohol.
Everybody knows that's not a difference of opinion.
Yeah. You know when he drank it? It wasn't even the early stage of al-Islam. You might say, oh, but are you sure he didn't hear the hadith? Mm. No. It was the time of Umar. Umar actually appointed him as the leader, as Abdul Razak ibn Hammam al-San'ani mentioned in his Musannaf. He appointed him as the leader for what? For the people of Bahrain. And that's where he mentioned that he was drinking alcohol. So Umar radiallahu anhu confronted him. He said, yeah. So Umar said, hey, why? He said, didn't Allah not say in the Quran, لَيْسَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ جُنَاحُ فِي مَا طَعِمُوا إِذَا مَتَّقُوا. He said, there's no harm. If a person comes with the quality of taqwa, what they drink or what they eat doesn't matter. Is that not an ayah that's shubha, right?
Okay, but where are you getting this story from?
Abdul Razak ibn Hammam al-Sanani mentions in his Musannaf.
Authentic.
It's authentic. Yes, authentic. It's authentic. I'm telling you now, pay attention here. This is a sahabiyun badiriyun shahida uhud. He's from the sabiqeen al-awwaleen, the early people to Islam. Can somebody today say, based on the action of this companion, Qudamah ibn Mad'un, it is permissible for me to drink alcohol?
No, of course, there's not. Well, it's well known that there's no difference.
Akhi, and I really, like this, Qudamah ibn Mad'un brought evidences for his action. Husayn didn't.
He just did the action. He didn't even do the action. He supposedly did the action.
Which I'm going to come to right with Khuruj. But even if I do say, he did Khuruj. Can we say, based on Qudamah ibn Mad'un's action, that is a difference of opinion on this issue?
No.
Can we say that?
No, of course not.
If you say to me about Umar radiallahu anhu corrected him, same with Husayn. If you say to me, Qudamah ibn Mad'un was corrected for what he did, and Umar radiallahu anhu actually lashed him for it, I'm going to say to you, the same applies with Husayn's action. Actually, more people critiqued Husayn on this action that we textually have than Qudamah ibn Mad'un's action. عرفت؟
And as you can see on screen, we've got the book Hilyatul Awliya, and he says that Imam Sufyan al-Thawri says, whoever made dua for an oppressor to remain has loved that Allah be disobeyed. Okay, so as you can see on screen, we've got the book Tahdibul Kamal fi Asma'i Rijal by Hafid al-Mizzi, and he mentions, now we're going back to Sufyan al-Thawri again, he says that a man saw Sufyan al-Thawri. Okay, a man saw Sufyan al-Thawri. And he says, Ya Aba Abdullah, oh Aba Abdullah, you are carrying all of these gold, these dananir, this money. You're carrying all of this money. He says, Uskut. He goes, be quiet. Shut your mouth. Falawla hadihi dananir. If it wasn't for this gold, if it wasn't for this money, the rulers would make us into their handkerchiefs. Okay, the rules will make us into their handkerchiefs. Subhanallah al-Azim. Look at that.
There's something very powerful I want to mention here. It was mentioned Ibn Abi Hatim in his Kitab al-Jarh wa-Ta'dil. بسند صحيح, he mentions that عبد الرحمن بن مهدي, he said, ما سمعت سفيان, I never heard سفيان يعني ever يعني يسب أحدا من السلطان, ever insult, يعني speaking, you know, against the سلطان قط في شدته عليهم, even though he was harsh against them. What does it mean? This is the power of a great imam like this. When he would sit with them, he wasn't soft.
When he was in their presence, he wasn't soft.
مع شدته عليهم, أما في شدته عليهم. When he sat with them, he gave it to them the way it was. But when he left them, he would never speak about them. It was also narrated by عبد الرحمن المهدي that he mentioned that سفيان يقول, he used to say, إني لأدعو للسلطان. I make dua for the Sultan for goodness, ولكن لا أستطيع أن أذكر إلا بما فيه. And I can't stop myself except to mention that which is in him when I'm with. And when he's there, he'll tell him what he is.
Mm-hmm.
As soon as he meets him, he tells him everything. When he leaves him, he makes dua for him. Allahumma hadi ya rabbil alameen. This is tariqah to Ahlul Sunnah. The opposite is what we see with these people. When they sit with the leader, they start shivering and they get nervous and they can't say anything. They're warriors like when they walk out. As soon as they go online, they come out. The mujrim, the fasiq, the kadhib, the...
صحيح مسلم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال وإن أخذ مالك وضرب ظهرك فاسمع وأطع
نعم.
فيظن أن هذا في أخذ مالك بالحرام وهذا تفسير غريب جدا لكن لا يمكن أن يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وإن أخذ مالك بغير حق جلد ظهرك بغير حق
يعني يدعوك وهو الذي الزل
وهو الذي دعاك إلى قال المقتول دون ماله شهيد والمقتول دون أهله شهيد والمقتول دون عرضه شهيد
نعم
والمقتول دون دينه شهيد
when you got oppression You defend your family, your wealth, and your honor. And the Prophet ﷺ said, "Man kutina duna malihi fa huwa shaheed. Man kutina duna irdihi fa huwa shaheed. Whoever defends his honor is a shaheed. Man kutina duna madmatihi fa huwa shaheed. Whoever defends himself against oppression is a shaheed."
How do you reconcile it with a clear-cut, authentic hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, which clearly goes against this particular hadith? "Man kutina duna malihi fa huwa shaheed." So one hadith is saying quite clearly, and we both agree it's authentic, it's saying anybody who dies is praising the person who dies protecting his wealth or protecting his property. He dies as a shaheed. So the Prophet ﷺ is praising the one who fights when he's protecting his wealth or his property. The other one, which you're saying is authentic now, is saying the complete opposite. If the ruler takes your wealth, be patient. How do you reconcile the two?
So Shai, in response to what you just said right now, the issue of that من قتل دون ماله فهو شهيد.
Yeah.
The ulama are مجمعون, the scholars are unanimous in agreement that the hakim does not enter this hadith. And Imam Ibn al-Mundhir rahimahullah mentioned something, I transmitted this statement before, and this statement Ibn Hajar brings it in his Kitab Fathul Bari, and he kind of affirms it, or he does affirm it, in the fifth volume, 124. Also, Ibn al-Mundhir's initial statement, you can actually find it in his Kitab al-Ishraf, ala madahib al-ulama, the seventh volume, page 248, where he says, وَهَذَا يَقُولُ عَوَامُ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ إِنَّ لِلْرَجُلِ أَن يُقَاتِلَ عَن نَفْسِهِ. A person can defend himself. وَمَالِهِ وَأَهْلِهِ, his family and his wealth. He can. وَإِذَا أُرِيدَ ظُلْمًا, if oppression is intended for him. لِلْأَخْبَارِ الَّتِي جَاءَتْ عَن رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ, because of the evidences that have come from the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام. لَمْ تُخَصَّ وَقْتٌ دُونَ وَقْتٍ, it hasn't specified a time at another time. وَلَا حَالًا دُونَ حَالٍ, not one situation over another. And you can always defend your wealth, defend your family, if someone wants to oppress you and wrong you, because of the evidence that have come from the Prophet, he said.
Okay.
Then look what he said, إِلَّا السُّلْطَانِ.
Which goes back to what you actually said before when we brought the other hadith in Sahih Bukhari.
إِلَّا السُّلْطَانِ, he said, except the leader. فَإِنَّ جَمَاعَةَ أَهْلِ الْحَدِيثِ, because of the people of hadith, كَالْمُجْمِعِينَ, they are unanimous in agreement of what? عَلَى أَنَّ مَنْ لَمْ يُمْكِنُوا أَنْ يَمْنَعَ نَفْسَهُ وَمَالَهُ إِلَّا بِالْخُرُوجِ عَلَى السُّلْطَانِ وَمُحَارَبَتِهِ إِنَّهُ لَا يُحَارِبُ. If you, يعني أهل الحديث, يعني أهل السنة, are unanimously in agreement upon what? عَلَى أَنَّ مَنْ لَمْ يُمْكِنُهُ, if it's not possible for a person, أَنْ يَمْنَعَ نَفْسَهُ وَمَالَهُ, that he can't defend his wealth and his family, or he can't, sorry, defend himself and his wealth, إِلَّا بِالْخُرُوجِ عَلَى السُّلْطَانِ, only to go against him, that's the only way he can. What do they all unanimously agree upon? أَنَّهُ لَا يُحَارِبُ, he can't fight him with him like this. وَلَا يَخْرُجُ عَلَيْهِ, and he can't do خُرُوج on him. لِلْأَخْبَارِ الدَّالَّةِ عَلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, عَلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ, because of the evidence that have come from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, التي فيها الأمر بالصبر, which commands us to be patient, على ما يكون منه من الجور, because of the oppression that comes from the leader, والظلم, وترك قتالهم والخروج عليهم, ما أقاموا الصلاة, as long as they establish the prayer. So this is not a difference of opinion, it's an إجماع is mentioned. He mentions the إجماع, فإن جماعة أهل الحديث كالمجمعين. أي نعم.
النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال وإن أخذ مالك وضرب ظهرك فاسمع وأطع.
نعم.
فيظن أن هذا في أخذ مالك بالحرام. وهذا تفسير غريب جدا. فلذلك المقصود إن أخذ مالك بحق.
نعم.
وجلد ظهرك بحق.
نعم.
لكن لا يمكن أن يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وإن أخذ مالك بغير حق وجلد ظهرك بغير حق.
فإن ضرب ظهرك فأخذ مالك بحق. Are you saying to me?
Okay, I've got one more thing that I want to put forward in terms of this particular hadith, and that is that even if we say, for argument's sake, that this hadith is authentic, especially this part about flogging your back and taking your wealth, Ibn Hazm explains how to understand it. He said that this isn't talking about when the ruler flogs your back and takes your wealth unjustly. Rather, it's talking about when it is deserved. For example, taking your wealth and raising taxes, methalan, or flogging your back as part of like a punishment, then obey and listen. But if he's doing it unjustly, no.
That's far-fetched. Wallah, if you look at the siyaq of the hadith, it doesn't allow it. قلوبهم قلوب الشياطين. You know, do these people look like they're doing something from the religion? The hadith mentions they're not taking my sunnah as the sunnah. They're not taking my guidance as a guidance.
Mm.
Yani, the context does not support Ibn Hazm's understanding. Not to mention Suwayd Ibn Ghafala's statement when Umar radiallahu anhu said to him that he said, "Fasma wa ati' wa in umir alayka abdun habashiyun mujid in daraba, if he bashes and lashes you, just be patient. Wa in haramaka, if he prevents you from something, fasbir, be patient. Hatta look what he said, wa in amara wa in arad amran yantaqisu dinak, if he tries to say or makes you do and puts you, commands you a matter that puts your deen down, even then say to him, سَمْعٌ وَطَاعَةٌ, I listen and I obey. Say that to him. But then look what say, وَدَمِ دُونَ دِينِ. My blood comes before my deen. You will beat me, but I won't let you get to my religion. I won't obey you in disobedience. Then he said, فَلَا تُفَارِقِ الْجَمَاعَةِ. Don't go against the jama'ah. Shahid, he took your wealth, he took your lash, your back, he took every, even came to your religion, you still say, I'm going to obey you in everything else, but this issue, wallahi, I'm going to die. See, I'm going to die. And he told you, فَلَا تُفَارِقِ الْجَمَاعَةِ. Don't go against the jama'ah. This is going to get very tough now, but I'm not going to only prove that it's ijma'. I'm actually going to prove that it's not only ijma', but rather it's ijma' plus anyone who doesn't hold this opinion is a misguided individual.
Okay.
That is not min ahli sunnah. That's the 2 points I'm going to affirm here, bi'nillah al-kareem. Let me start with the ijma'.
Okay.
The first one is Shaykh al-Islam, imamu ahli sunnati wal jama'a bila mudafa'a, without any disputation, argumentation, al-imamu Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahimahullah ta'ala. Al-imamu Ahmad, his statement you can find in his usul sunnah. Okay, he says, وَمَنْ خَرَجَ عَلَى إِمَامٍ مِّنْ أَيْمَةِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Anyone who goes out against a oppressive Muslim leader. Sorry, he says, وَمَنْ خَرَجَ عَلَى إِمَامٍ مِّنْ أَيْمَةِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Anyone who goes against a Muslim leader. He doesn't say oppressive. He just says, anyone who goes against a Muslim leader. وَقَدْ كَانُوا اجْتَمَعُوا عَلَيْهِ. The people have come together under this leader. وَأَقَرُّوا لَهُ بِالْخِلَافَةِ. And they've affirmed for him khilafah. Now, someone might come and say, oh, you see, he's talking about khilafah here. What we have to understand is after Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu ta'ala anhu, since Uthman's throw, as I'm going to mention later, the Muslims haven't all united under one person, except few. Muawiyah was said, Sah, and a few others.
Okay.
The overwhelming bulk of Islamic history is that even Ali ibn Abi Talib wouldn't be a khilafah to these people. Because Ali ibn Abi Talib didn't have control over Sham. Would that make his khilafah illegitimate?
No, of course not.
So then when Imam Ahmed saying, وَأَقَرُّوا بِالْخِلَافَةِ, he's saying what? He's saying, Ali ibn Abi Talib is a khalifatul lil-Muslimin. And no one disputes that. But he didn't have control of Sham. Sham was under Muawiyah. Muawiyah was not claiming khilafah, la shak. Lakin he didn't, the bay'ah of the people of Sham was not in the hands of Ali ibn Abi Talib. So saying that is... argument is oh,
I'm going to go into it more detail later.
Inshallah, inshallah. وَقَدْ كَانُوا اجْتَمَعُوا عَلَيْهِ وَأَقَرُّوا لَهُ بِالْخِلَافَةِ وَأَقَرُّوا بِالْخِلَافَةِ بِأَيِّ وَجْهٍ كَانَ بِالرِّضَى أَوْ بِالْغَلَبَةِ. Ahmed says, whether they given this khilafah to him by them being pleased with him or غَلَبَة, he forcefully took over. فَقَدْ شَقَّ هَذَا الْخَارِجُ عَسَى الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَخَالَفَ الْآثَارَ عَنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. This person has gone against, first of all, this person has يعني فَقَدْ شَقَّ هَذَا الْخَارِجُ عَصَى الْمُسْلِمِينَ. He has broken the ranks of the believers. وَخَالَفَ الْآثَارَ. And this person has gone against the textual evidences. So there's no rights for that person to call themselves Athari, etc. عَنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. They went against the آثار transmitted from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. فَإِنْ مَاتَ الْخَارِجُ. That person who exited from that leader, he, what does he do? فَإِنْ مَاتَ الْخَارِجُ عَلَيْهِ مَاتَ مِيتَةً جَاهِلِيَّةً. That person dies the death of jahiliyyah. وَلَا يَحِلُّ قِتَالَ السُّلْطَانِ. It is not permissible to fight with the leader. وَلَا الْخُرُوجَ عَلَيْهِ. It is not permissible for you to go out against him. لِأَحَدٍ مِنَ النَّاسِ. Anybody whatsoever. فَمَنْ فَعَلَ ذَلِكَ. And anyone who does, فَهُوَ مُبْتَدِعٌ عَلَى غَيْرِ السُّنَّةِ. So Ahmed said he is a mubtadi' and he's upon a path other than the path of the sunnah.
And use the word men, anybody.
Anyone. I want you to look at a mas'ala. Ahmed spoke about two types of leaders. He said, بِالرِّضَى أَوْ الْغَلَبَة. Rida is one that people are pleased with, and he's adil, just, and people like him, they're happy with him. Ghalaba is one who came by force, oppression, and wrongdoing. He forced himself into the people. So that's a sign of fisq.
Yeah.
So Ahmed said that even that way you can't go against him. Allah rahmatan wasi'ah. So Ahmed ibn Hanbal is the first imam that I mentioned. The second imam I'm going to mention is an imam Ali ibn al-Madini, who is the sheikh of al-imam al-Bukhari.
Okay.
He said, As-sunnatu al-lazimah allati man tarakaha minha khaslatun lam yaqulha aw lam yu'min biha lam yakun min ahliha. Ahmed ibn Hanbal, he said, the sunnah which is, Al-Imam Ali ibn al-Madini, he said, the sunnah which is lazim, anyone who leaves it, any of these points, lam yaqul, or he doesn't say it, or he doesn't believe it, he's not from his people. So he's not min ahli sunnah.
Okay.
And from the things he mentioned is what? وَمَنْ خَرَجَ عَلَى إِمَامٍ مِّنْ أَيْمَةِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَقَدْ اجْتَمَعَ عَلَيْهِ النَّاسُ فَأَقَرُّوا لَهُ بِالْخِلَافَةِ بأي وجه كانت بالرضا كانت أو بالغلبة فقد شق هذا الخارج عصى أو خالف الآثار عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فإن مات الخارج عليه مات ميتة جاهلية ولا يحل قتال السلطان ولا الخروج عليه لأحد من الناس فمن عمل ذلك فهو مبتدع على غير سنة. Same thing Ahmad ibn Hanbal said. He took him out of Ahl Sunnah.
And he transmitted Juma'ah as well.
Al-Imaman, Abu Hatim and Abu Zur'at al-Raziyani, both of them. What did they say? Adarakna al-ulama'a fi jami'i al-amsar. Both of them have aqidah books called Aqidah al-Raziyani.
So just to go back to Ali al-Madini, he said he transmitted Juma'ah, right?
Yeah,
where was that statement found?
It's found in his kitab. You can find Abu Qasim ibn Tullah al-Lalaka'i, he mentions in his first volume, page 185. It's called Aqidah Ali min al-Madini.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Then we have Al-Imamani, Abu Hatim, and Abu Zur'at al-Raziyani. Beginning of their book, what did they say? أَدَرَكْنَا الْعُلَمَاءَ فِي جَمِيعِ الْأَمْصَارِ حِجَازًا وَعِرَاقًا وَشَامًا وَيَمَنًا فَكَانَ مِنْ مَذْهَبِهِمْ. So we met all the ulama from what? Hijaz. We met all the ulama from Iraq and Sham and Yemen. And their madhab was, Al-Ijma'. This is all of them what they agreed upon. And I thought that book is online. From the things they mentioned that they all believed in is what? وَلَا نَرَى الْخُرُوجَ عَلَى الْأَئِمَّةِ وَلَا الْقِتَالِ فِي الْفِتْنَةِ وَنَسْمَعُ وَنُطِيعُ لِمَنْ وَلَّاهُ اللَّهُ أَمْرَنَا وَلَا نَنْزِعُ يَدًا مِنْ طَاعَةٍ وَنَتَّبِعُ السُّنَّةَ وَالْجَمَاعَةَ وَنَجْتَرِبُ الشُّذُوذَ وَالْخِلَافَ وَالْفُرْقَةِ. So we follow Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. We don't go with the strange يعني, view and the disunity. Harb al-Kirmani in his Aqidah, in which he learned from Ahl Sunnah, he says, وَالْإِنْقِيَادُ لِمَنْ وَلَّاهُ اللَّهُ أَمْرَكَ لا تنزع يدك من طاعة ولا تخرج عليه بسيفك حتى يجعل الله لك فرجا ومخرجا وألا تخرج على السلطان وتسمع وتطيع ولا تنكث بيعه فمن فعل ذلك فهو مبتدع مخارق مفارق للجماعة وإن أمرك السلطان بأمر هو لله معصية فليس لك أن تطيعه البتة وليس لك أن تخرج عليه ولا تمنعه. So here Harb al-Kirmani mentions إجماع, and he also mentions what? And he also mentions the innovation of that person, that he's misguided and he's innovated. Abu Uthman al-Sabuni, which is the fifth, he says, يَرَى أَصْحَابُ الْحَدِيثِ أَصْحَابُ الْحَدِيثِ they see, and أهل السنة, الْجُمُعَةَ وَالْعِيدَيْنِ وَغَيْرِهِمَا مِنَ الصَّلَوَاتِ خَلْفَ كُلِّ إِمَامٍ بَرٍ كَانَ أَوْ فَاجِرًا. That we pray, we do Jumu'ah and Eidain, all the salahs between, behind the what? An imam who is obedient or he's a transgressor. وَيَرَوْنَ جِهَادَ الْكَفَرَةِ مَعَهُمْ. And we fight with him in the jihad. وَإِنْ كَانُوا جَوْرَةً فَجَرَةً. Even if they are transgressive, oppressive leaders. وَيَرَوْنَ الدُّعَاءَ لَهُمْ. And they see making dua for them. بِالْإِصْلَاحِ وَالتَّوْفِيقِ وَالصَّلَاحِ وَبَسْطِ الْعَدْلِ فِي الرَّعِيَّةِ. وَلَا يَرَوْنَ الْخُرُوجَ عَلَيْهِمْ بِالسَّيْفِ وَإِنْ رَأَوْا مِنْهُمُ الْعُدُولَ عَنِ الْعَدْلِ إِلَى الْجَوْرِ وَالْحَيْفِ. Even if they see from him that he deviated from justice and fairness. Al-Imam al-Muzani, the student of Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, has a kitab in Aqidah. And look what he said. At the beginning he says,
what's the book called?
It's called Sharh al-Sunnah. Sharh al-Sunnah al-Imam al-Muzani. And al-Imam al-Sabuni, he mentions that in his Aqidah to Salaf wa Ashab al-Hadith.
Okay.
Al-Muzani, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, from the Aqidah of Ahl al-Sunnah is, وَتَرْكُ الْخُرُوجِ عِنْدَ تَعَدِّيهِمْ وَجَوْرِهِمْ وَالتَّوْبَةُ إِلَى اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ كَمَا يَعْطِفُ بِهِمْ عَلَى رَعِيَتِهِمْ. He's actually saying to the people, go and do what? Repent to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, so Allah can put in their hearts kindness and generosity towards you. In there, he mentions in his kitab, هذه مقالات وأفعال اجتمع عليه الماضون الأولون من أئمة الهدى. This is all of this I mentioned here. He said is what the أئمة الماضون, the early scholars of Islam, all of them agreed upon. Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani, who's called Malik al-Saghir, his Aqidah book. He said, والسمع والطاعة لأئمة المسلمين وكل من ولي أمر المسلمين عن رضا أو عن غلبة واشتد وطأته. He says, وَطْأَتُهُ sorry, مِنْ بَرٍ أَوْ فَاجِرٍ فَلَا يُخْرَجُ عَلَيْهِ جَارَ أَوْ عَدَلٍ. You're not allowed to go against him, whether he's oppressive or not. And then after that, look what he said. وَكُلُّ مَا قَدَّمْنَا ذِكْرَهُ. Everything we've mentioned here in our Aqidah book, فَهُوَ قَوْلُ أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ وَأَيْمَّةِ النَّاسِ فِي الْفِقْهِ وَالْحَدِيثِ. This is the view of Ahl Sunnah, the people of fiqh, عَلَى مَا بَيَّنَّاهُ, as we have mentioned. وَكُلُّ قَوْلُ مَالِكٍ. وَكُلُّهُ قَوْلُ مَالِكٍ. And all of this is also the statement of Imam Malik. فمنه منصوص من قوله ومنه معلوم من مذهبه. Ibn Hajar brings the statement of Ibn Battal and he affirms it. He mentions the statement of Ibn Battal and agrees to it, where he says في الحديث حجة في ترك الخروج على السلطان ولو جارا وقد أجمع الفقهاء على وجوب طاعة السلطان المتغلب والجهاد معه وأن طاعته خير من الخروج عليه لما في ذلك من حقن الدماء وتسكين الدهماء وحجتهم هذا الخبر وغيره مما يساعده ولم يستثنوا من ذلك إلا إذا وقع من السلطان الكفر الصريع. The only exception they gave, he said, is what? If he comes with clicker, كفر. فلا تجوز طاعته في ذلك بل تجلب مجاهدته لمن قدر عليها كما في الحديث الذي بعده. And half the Hajj brought the statement of Ibn Battal and he affirmed it.
And where did he bring that?
In his Fathul Bari, Ibn Hajar brings it, volume 13, page 7.
Okay.
And also you can find it in Ibn Battal Sharh of Bukhari. It's published. It's the 10th volume, page 8. Now, Ibn Hajar brought the statement of Ibn Battal, and Ibn Battal said, وَقَدْ أَجْمَعَ الْفُقَهَ عَلَى وُجُوبِ السَّمْعِ وَالطَّاعَةِ upon the oppressive Muslim leader, I mean the Mutaghallib, Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah. He mentions this in Hadith Ubaid al-Musam in Sharh Sahih Muslim. Ibn Taymiyyah in his kitab Minhaj al-Sunnah al-Nabawiyyah, he said, استقر أمر أهل السنة على ترك القتال في الفتنة للأحاديث الصحيحة الثابتة عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وصاروا يذكرون هذا في عقائدهم ويأمرون بالصبر على جور الأئمة وترك قتالهم. أهل السنة والجماعة, this is their عقيدة. This is where after fitna of Ibn Ash'ath, after some of the Tabi'in did Khuruj, and then the fitna of Ibn Ash'ath happened, Ahl al-Sunnah started to document that this is the only view. This is it. And they mentioned that in their books of Aqidah, and they commanded the people to be patient upon the oppressive Muslim leader and leave off going against him. ولذلك he said, ولهذا كان مذهب أهل الحديث ترك الخروج بالقتال على الملوك البغاة والصبر على ظلمهم إلى أن يستريح بر أو يستراح من فاجر. So many statements he has, رحمه الله تعالى. I need to mention Imam al-Bukhari because this one's very powerful.
Yeah, and plus he's someone that everybody knows.
Bukhari said, لقيت أكثر من ألف رجل. I met more than 1,000 men.
Wow.
من أهل العلم, أهل الحجاز وبكة والمدينة والكوفة والبصرة وواسط وبغداد والشام ومصر. لقيتهم كرات. I met them time after time. قرنا بعد قرن ثم قرنا بعد قرن. أدركتهم. I met them all. متوافرون أكثر من 46 سنة. 46 years. أهل الشام ومصر والجزيرة مرتين والبصرة 4 مرات في سنين ذوي عدد بالحجاز 6 أعوام ولا أحصي على الدولة كم دخلت الكوفة وبغداد مع محدث أهل خراسان منهم. And then he mentions all people he met. He mentions all of them. And then look what he says after that. After he mentions all of them, he mentions what they believed and their aqidah. He mentions their aqidah is what? وَأَلَّا نُنَازِعَ الْأَمْرَ أَهْلَهُ. That we don't go against oppressive Muslim leader. لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, because of the Prophet's statement, and then he mentions the hadith, and then after, look what he says, وَأَلَّا يَرَى السَّيْفَ عَلَى أُمَّةِ مُحَمَّدٍ, and they do not see the sword upon أُمَّةِ Muhammad. Al-Imam al-Lalaka'i mentions that in his kitab Sharh Usul I'tiqad Ahli Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. So they don't believe to huggle with the people of authority. He's mentioned ulama Mecca wal-Madina wal-Kufa wal-Basra wa-Wasit wa-Baghdad wa-Sham wa-Misra wa-Khurasan, and he's mentioned them what? 46 years. He's mentioned the aqidah. He's mentioned them level after level. When he said karat, he means jil ba'd jil, generation after generation. That's Al-Imam Al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala and his statement. Also, Ibn Mundhir's initial statement, you can actually find it in his kitab Al-Ishraf ala madahib al-ulama, the 7th volume, page 248, where he says, وَهَذَا يَقُولُ عَوَامُ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ إِنَّ لِلْرَجُلِ أَنْ يُقَاتِلَ عَنْ نَفْسِهِ. A person can defend himself. وَمَالِهِ وَأَهْلِهِ, his family and his wealth. He can. وَإِذَا أُرِيدَ ظُلْمًا, if oppression is intended for him. لِلْأَخْبَارِ الَّتِي جَاءَتْ عَنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ, because of the evidences that have come from the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام. لَمْ تُخَصَّ وَقْتٌ دُونَ وَقْتٍ, it hasn't specified a time at another time. وَلَا حَالًا دُونَ حَالٍ, not one situation over another. And you can always defend your wealth, defend your family if someone wants to oppress you and wrong you. Because of the evidence that have come from the Prophet, he said.
Okay.
Then look what he said, إِلَّا السُّلْطَانِ.
Which goes back to what you actually said before when we brought the other hadith in Sahih Bukhari.
إِلَّا السُّلْطَانِ, he said, except the leader. فَإِنَّ جَمَاعَةَ أَهْلِ الْحَدِيثِ, because of the people of hadith, كَالْمُجْمِعِينَ, they are unanimous in agreement of what? عَلَى أَنَّ مَنْ لَمْ يُمْكِنُوا أَنْ يَمْنَعَ نَفْسَهُ وَمَالَهُ إِلَّا بِالْخُرُوجِ عَلَى السُّلْطَانِ وَمُحَارَبَتِهِ إِنَّهُ لَا يُحَارِبُ. If you, يعني أهل الحديث, يعني أهل السنة, are unanimously in agreement upon what? عَلَى أَنَّ مَنْ لَمْ يُمْكِنُهُ, if it's not possible for a person, أَنْ يَمْنَعَ نَفْسَهُ وَمَالَهُ, that he can't defend his wealth and his family, or he can't, sorry, defend himself and his wealth, إِلَّا بِالْخُرُوجِ عَلَى السُّلْطَانِ, only to go against him, that's the only way he can. What did they all unanimously agree upon? أَنَّهُ لَا يُحَارِبُ, he can't fight him with him like this. وَلَا يَخْرُجُ عَلَيْهِ, and he can't do خُرُوج on him. لِلْأَخْبَارِ الدَّالَّةِ عَلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, عَلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ, because of the evidence that have come from the Prophet صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, الَّتِي فِيهَا الْأَمْرُ بِالصَّبْرِ, which commands us to be patient, عَلَى مَا يَكُونُ مِنْهُ مِنَ الْجَوْرِ, because of the oppression that comes from the leader, وَالظُّلْمِ وَتَرْكُ قِتَالِهِمْ وَالْخُرُوجِ عَلَيْهِمْ مَا أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ, as long as they established the prayer. So this is not a difference of opinion, it's an ijma' as mentioned. He mentions the ijma'. فَإِنَّ جَمَعَةَ أَهْلِ الْحَدِيثِ كَالْمُجْمِعِنَا. Now I want to go into the sixth qa'idah that I want inshallah ta'ala to drive home. I want people to listen to this one as well. It's very important for me, which is, in this qa'idah, I want to speak about Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And I can actually say this is one of the most important ones for me.
Okay.
But it's not that the others are not important.
Sure.
But this is very important for me, which is Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. They mention, they state that going against the hakim who is zalim or fasiq or he's a mubtadi' madam a Muslim, as long as he's a Muslim, going against him, they believe that this is wrong. It is haram. You're a sinner for doing this. Also, they believe, Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they believe that it's obligatory to listen to him and obey him as long as he doesn't command you or tell you to do that which is disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
In which case, you don't obey him in that thing, but you obey him in everything
in the rest
else.
Of the things.
Okay.
Now, inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to give evidence for that statement of mine. But before I go into it, I want to first of all mention that the evidence I'm going to bring are mutawatir.
What does that mean?
It means it reached haddu tawatir, which is mass transmission. It is multitude narration. This issue is not khabar ahad, few narrations here or there. Even though we will take, even if it's few narrations, we will take it. If Allah and His Messenger, or if the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said it, and it's few in narration, we'll still take it. Mm-hmm. It's evidence, it's a proof.
Yeah.
But it gets even more serious when those narrations are mutawatir. And this is powerful for me because later I want to go back to an issue which is majalatul ijtihad. Places where ijtihad can enter. When can you do ijtihad? You're not allowed to do ijtihad if a nas is qat'iyu thubut, qat'iyu dilala. There's no ijtihad for you.
What do those terms mean?
If the transmission of these narrations are established, they've reached you through mutawatir. If it's reached you through mutawatir, and the indication in these texts are clear cut, you're not allowed to do any.
Okay.
And on top of that, if there's an ijma on it, all that's open for you is sami'na wa ata'na. And I want to prove that this is the case. Before I go in, I can't just claim that it's mutawatir and just leave it like that. I need to mention who said it's mutawatir.
Okay.
But if anybody goes out there and looks at all of the narrations, they will see that it's mutawatir. But then I'm going to mention some scholars who said it. The student of Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Al-Imam Al-Athram, rahimahullah ta'ala, is a kitab called Hanasiq al-Hadith wa Mansukhi, page 257. He says, ثم تواترت الحديث عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فكثرت عنه وعن الصحابة والأئمة بعدهم. He mentions that it's mutawatir from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, the hadiths. And they are large in number, he says. فَكَثُرَتْ عَنْهُ يعني, a lot have come from him. Not only him, وَعَنِ الصَّحَابَةِ, the companions, and also أئمة, that came after. Also, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, in his kitab al-Istiqamah, the first volume, page 34, he says, رَحِمَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى, he said, نَهَى النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمْ عَنْ قِتَالِ الْأَئِمَّةِ إِذَا كَانَ فِيهِمْ ظُلْمٌ. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he prohibited fighting with the oppressive Muslim leaders. لِأَنَّ, he says, Ibn Taymiyyah, قِتَالَهُمْ فِيهِ فَسَادٌ أَعْظَمُ مِنْ فَسَادِ ظُلْمِهِمْ. Because fighting with them is a greater harm than the current harm, which is their oppression. وَعَلَى هَذَا, and because of that, فَمَا وَرَدَ فِي صَحِيحِ الْبُخَارِي, the narration that came in Sahih al-Bukhari, مِنْ حَدِيثِ أُمِّ سَلَمَةَ, he said, and the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qala, that the Prophet said, and then after he said, لَيْسَ هُوَ مُخَالِفًا, it is not in opposition to what? لِمَا تَوَاتَرَ عَنْهُ, those narrations that have come from him in mass transmission. And in the narrations that have come, prohibiting us from going against the oppressive Muslim leader. The third Imam who said this is Al-Imam al-Shawkani in his kitab Nail al-Awtar. In the seventh volume, page 367, he says, Rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَهِيَ مُتَوَاتِرَةً. Yani these narrations are mutawatira. And you know the mutawatira are two types. We study this in Mustalah al-Hadith, right? There's two types of mutawatir. There's mutawatir which is lafzi, and there's a mutawatir which is ma'nawi. Shawkani rahimullah, he says that it's mutawatir ma'nawi. He says, وَهِيَ مُتَوَاتِرَةُ الْمَعْنَى كَمَا يَعْرِفُ ذَلِكَ مَنْ لَهُ أَنَسَةٌ بِعِلْمِ السُّنَّةِ. Anyone who has spent a short period of time and accompanied hadiths will know that this is mutawatir. In other words, if you have smelled the fragrance of knowledge, and if the fragrance of knowledge just reached you, you would know that it's what? Mass transmission. عبادة بن صامت رضي الله تعالى عنه said, بايعنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم على السمع في المنشط والمكره وعسرنا ويسرنا وأثرة علينا وألا ننازع الأمر أهله. فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إلا أن تروا كفرا بواحا عندكم من الله فيه برهان. The shahid I want from the hadith, the part I want to take from the hadith is وألا ننازع الأمر أهله, that we can't go against the oppressive leader. So we're not allowed to, sorry, وألا ننازع, we are not allowed to. منازعة means we can't huggle.
Yeah, struggle. Yeah.
With الأمر أهله, the people of authority. Then the ayah, hadith mentioned, sorry, إلا أن تروا كفرا بواحا عندكم من الله فيه برهان. There are two عموم in this text. There are two generalizations. The first one is أهله. The word أهله, the word أهل is a نكرة. And then it's been attributed to the ضمير here. فأفادة العموم. It shows generalization. Every leader. Also, another evidence to show that there's umum in here is the istithna that was mentioned after it. Illa. And the scholars, they say, al-istithna'u mi'yaru al-umum. That the istithna shows that the generalization was there. Because when you mention general, you only take something out of
it. Right.
This evidence is what shows that when he's a kafir, we don't listen to him.
Okay.
This one, take the kafir out of it. Okay. The third evidence that I want to bring, inshallah ta'ala, to listen and obey the oppressive Muslim leader, and that we're not allowed to do khuruj on him, is the hadith of Alqamah ibn Wa'il al-Hadrami that he narrated from his father. Before I go into this hadith, let me go back to hadith Ubadah ibn Salam. It's very important. Ubadah said, I took a pledge of allegiance with the Prophet. Bay'ah. And the pledge of allegiance I took from him is that I'm going to listen and I'm going to obey when I'm in times of ease, times of hardship, when it's وَأَثَرَةٍ عَلَيْنَا, when I see favoritism from the leader. Yani he's oppressing. He's taking things for himself. He's giving it to his people. His favoritism. Dhulm he's doing. The Prophet said to us at that moment, وَأَلَّا نُنَازِعَ الْأَمْرَ أَهْلَهُ. Do not try to remove him from his position or try to pull and push with him those people of authority. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, he said, إِلَّا أَكْسَبْتُوا أَنْ تَرَوْ كُفْرًا بَوَاحًا عِنْدَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ فِيهِ بُرْهَانٍ, unless you see clear-cut kufr from him. That you have a proof for يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ. That's the time when you can go against him and you can يعني go against him. So those two points, which is ahlahu, which is lafdun, which is am, the word ahl is a nakiratun, it's attributed to that damir, so it shows generalization. And then the illa antaraw, which is istithna, and I said istithna is mi'yarul umum, this shows that it's referring to every hakim other than the kafir. The third one is Alqamah ibn Wa'ilin al-Hadrami. He said, I narrated from his father, that he said, سأل سلمة بن يزيد الجعفي. سلمة بن يزيد الجعفي, he said, I asked رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, Prophet of Allah, he said, يا نبي الله, أرأيت, do you not see, إن قامت علينا أمراء, leaders that come, يسألون حقهم, they start demanding for their rights, they give us our rights, ويمنعونا حقنا, but they don't give us our rights.
Right.
فما تأمرنا, what do you command us? Like, look what he said, فما تأمرنا, what do you command us? Not what do you suggest for us. It's important that we understand it, that the Sahabi asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam a clear-cut question. That's why I'm saying these evidences are sarihun, sahihun, and they are qat'iyu dilala. Their indications are crystal clear. Hence why the other party is saying that this is the right way. The other part is just a valid difference of opinion. So they don't deny that these are evidences and proofs. They shouldn't, because that's why they believe khuruj should not be done. These are the evidence they're using. Oh, I hope so. So Alqamah ibn Wa'il al-Hadrami narrated from his father, he said, Salamah ibn Yazid al-Ju'fi, you asked the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, Ya Nabi Allah, ara'ayta in qamat alayna umara, yas'aluna haqqahum, wa yamna'una haqqana, fama ta'muruna, what do you command us? The Prophet turned away from him. Fa'arada anhu. And then he asked him, Fa'arada anhu. The Prophet turned away from him. He asked him the third time, second time, third time, three times the Prophet turned away from him. Fajadabahu al-Ash'ath ibn Qaysin. Ash'ath ibn Qaysin. Yani pulled him, and the Prophet said, "Sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what? Listen and obey. Fima alayhim. Give them what is upon you from them. Ma hum upon them is what. Fina ma alayhim. Sorry, ma humilu alaykum ma humiltum. The sins that they accumulate and the wrongdoings, they're going to be held account for you. Everyone has to give their part.
And a command in the religion from
chance in usul al-fiqh shows obligation that it's an obligatory thing. Now look at the hadith." The Sahabi, the wajh al-dalala from the hadith I went from is in qamat alayna umara. Umara again is a what? Is a nakira. In the context of what? As a shart, a condition. It shows generalization, it shows all of the leaders. Not to mention that يمنعون حقنا. It shows you,
yeah, it shows you exactly,
that they're not going to give us our rights.
Yeah, that's an important point, because they might say that we do have external evidences for the first two evidences you brought that take the dhalim, the fasiq, out there. But this hadith clearly brings it in it there.
Brings it in there.
Okay.
The fourth evidence I want to bring is hadith Auf ibn Malik. Auf ibn Malik mentions that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَلَا مَنْ وَلِيَ عَلَيْهِ وَالٍ فَرَآهُ يَأْتِي شَيْئًا مِنْ مَعْصِيَةِ اللَّهِ فَلْيَكْرَهْ مَا يَأْتِي مِنْ مَعْصِيَةِ اللَّهِ وَلَا يَنْزَعْ عَنَّ يَدًا مِنْ طَاعَةٍ وَلَا يَنْزَعْ عَنَّ يَدًا مِنْ طَاعَةٍ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, alayhi salatu wa sallam, أَلَا مَنْ وَلِيَ عَلَيْهِ وَالٍ, anyone who a leader takes over his affairs, فَرَآهُ, and then sees that that leader, يَأْتِي شَيْئًا مِنْ مَعْصِيَةِ اللَّهِ, he's coming with sins, فَلْيَكْرَهْ, hate what he's doing, مَا يَأْتِي مِنْ مَعْصِيَةِ اللَّهِ, the sins that he's coming with, وَلَا يَنْزِعْ عَنَّ يَدًا مِنْ طَاعَةٍ, and do not pull your hand out.
Wow.
In obedience. Again, the word here that's used is a walin. Walin is ismu fa'il. It comes from the word waliya. It's ismu fa'il. Walin is a nakiratun fi siyaq al-sharti. What does it show? فَتُفِيدُ الْعُمُومِ. It shows generalization. Then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, clearly and categorically, what did he prohibit from? He prohibited from the munaza'a. He said, وَلَا يَنْزِعَنَّ. Do not do munaza'a, dispute with them and argue with them and do khuruj on them. The Prophet used the word yadan. Again, yadan is a wat'am, because it's a nakiratu fi siyaq al-nahi, right?
Yeah.
What does it show? Generalization. Yeah. So you can't pull your hand out in any way, shape, or form.
Yeah.
That's what the hadith is saying.
Wow.
Brother,
where's the hadith narrated?
The hadith is narrated in Sahih Muslim.
Okay.
And the hadith before that, it was narrated in Sahih Muslim as well. And the hadith before that, the hadith Al-Qamat ibn Wa'il al-Hadrami, Sahih Muslim. Hadith Auf ibn Malik is in Sahih Muslim. Hadith Ubadat ibn Samit is in Bukhari al-Muslim.
Wow.
So not, they're not going to weaken those narrations. I hope so. What I want to say to you is that, Shahid, something you're going to see now, which is, I just use the science known as Usul al-Fiqh and Qawa'id al-Fiqhiyya, which is very important science that many of these people who are talking about these issues don't have understanding of. And the scholars, they used to say, Man hurima al-Usula, hurima al-Wusula. Man hurima al-Usula, hurima al-Wusula. Anyone who's prohibited and prevented from knowing the Usul al-Fiqh, he's prohibited from reaching his goal. ولذلك, Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullah, has a little kitab in Qawa'id al-Fiqhiyya and Usul al-Fiqh as well. Qawa'id al-Usuliyya and Qawa'id al-Fiqhiyya, rahimahullah. Small kitab, students of knowledge, beginner students of knowledge do it. Right after they finish this kitab, they go for that one. Before they go for Al-Fara'id al-Bahiyya. It's a kitab, small kitab. In the Muqaddimah, he says, وَبَعْدُ فَالْعِلْمُ بُحُورٌ زَاخِرَةٌ لَيَبْلُغُ الْكَادِحُ فِيهِ آخِرَةٌ لَكِنْ فِي أُصُولِهِ تَسِيلًا لِلَيْلِهِ فَاحْرِصْ تَجِدْ سَبِيلًا اغتنم القواعد الأصول فمن تفته يحرم الوصول. He says, to proceed, knowledge is an ocean. You're not going to get to the end of it unless you go through usul al-fiqh. And you're not going to benefit from the Quran and Sunnah like that. And then he said, اغتنم القواعد الأصول. These قواعد and these usul benefit from it. Reap it. فمن تفته. Anyone who doesn't get given it, what happens to him? يحرم الوصول. He will be prevented from it. And hence why Islam is a unique religion over every other religion is because it mentions things to come in a principled manner.
Yeah.
The poet, he said, مَنْ اِهْتَدَى بِهَدِّهِ فَقَدْ ظَفِرْ وَمَنْ يَحِدْ عَنْ نَهْجِهِ فَقَدْ خَسِرْ تُلْفِي بِهِ إِلَى الْفَلَاحِ مَنْ هَجَى وَعَنْ جَمِيعِ الْمُعْضِلَاتِ مَخْرَجَى فَلَيْسَ خَيْرٌ قَطٌ إِلَّا قَرَّرَهُ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ مِنْ شَرٍّ إِلَّا حَذَّرَهُ فَدِينُنَا لَمْ يَخْلُ عَنْ حُكْمٍ عَلَى مَرِّ الزَّمَانِ لَوْ بَدَا مَا أَعْضَلَ لِأَنَّهُ قَدْ اِحْتَوَى قَوَاعِدَ تُسْتَخْرَجُ الْأَحْكَامَ عَنْهَا رَاشِدًا. Yani, principles are taken like that. Look how we just took nakiratu fi siyaq al-sharti, nakiratu fi siyaq al-umum, nakiratu udhifat ila ma'rifatin fatufid al-umum. And these are principles a person needs to know. ولذلك a poet, he said, يَظُنُّ الْغُمُرُ أَنَّ الْكُتْبَ تَهْدِي أَخَى فَهْمٍ لِإِدْرَاكِ الْعُلُومِ وَمَا يَدْرِي الْجَهُولُ بِأَنَّ فِيهَا غَوَامِضَ قَدْ حَيَّرَتْ عَقْلَ الْفَهِيمِ إذا رمت العلوم بغير شيخ ضللت عن الصراط المستقيم وتلتبس العلوم عليك حتى تصير أضل من توم الحكيم. The person just opens a book, hasn't studied the basic sciences. The person didn't study أصول الفقه, قواعد الفقهية, نحو, مصطلح الحديث, all of these sciences. You haven't studied it. And you just open big books like الاستذكار, التمهيد, you open البداية والنهاية, منهاج السنة النبوية. You open these books. You really haven't studied those little small متون that you can put in your pocket. What's going to happen to you? You're going to become, and you don't take knowledge from a sheikh and a teacher, ضَلَلْتَ عَنِ السَّرَاطِ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. You're going to be misguided from the straight path.
Yeah.
And the poet, he said, ضَلَلْتَ عَنِ السَّرَاطِ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ وَتَلْتَبِسُ الْعُلُومُ عَلَيْكَ حَتَّى. All of the science gets mixed up from you. حَتَّى تَصِيرَ أَضَلَّ مِنْ تَوْمَ الْحَكِيمِ. Until you become more misguided than تَوْمَ الْحَكِيمِ. You become a misguided person. You don't know what you're doing. You don't know your right hand from your left hand. And you come with things that مِمَّا تَضْحَكُ بِهِ ثَكْلَى. يعني مِمَّا تَضْحَكُ بِهِ ثَكْلَى, what it means is that the woman who lost her child or who lost her husband, at that time she's mourning, right? Even she will laugh at you.
SubhanAllah.
مِمَّا تَضْحَكُ بِهِ ثَكْلَى means the ثَكْلَى, the woman's crying, she's weeping. Even she will be laughing. She'll stop crying for a bit. She'll look at you and she'll laugh because she's like, what can possibly come from a person like this?
Yeah.
What I want to mention, inshallah ta'ala, is another evidence that the Prophet ﷺ, I want to support it, which is that the Prophet ﷺ, he mentions in the hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, the hadith of Bukhari and Muslim both narrated it, that the Prophet ﷺ, he said, إِنَّكُمْ سَتَلْقَوْنَ بَعْدِ أَثَارَةً وَأُمُورًا تُنْكِرُونَ. After my death, you're going to meet favoritism. Leaders who are just choosing things for themselves and their family, and that's it, oppression. وَأُمُورًا and matters تُنْكِرُونَهَا, you will reject. The Sahaba straight away, look what they said. فَمَا تَأْمُرُنَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, Messenger of Allah, what are you going to command us? You know these Sahabas, Shahid?
Yeah.
These Sahabas are Ahlul Badr, Uhud. They know fighting. They don't take oppression. They left their family and their children behind in Mecca. They're ready to fight anybody for the sake of the religion. And I'm going to mention some stories of the Salaf who spoke about their courage and their strength and how they would listen to the oppressive Muslim leader. I'm going to mention the Athar of the Salaf later, inshallah ta'ala. So when they asked straight away, they said, فَمَادَ تَأْمُرُنَا يَا رَسُولَ, what do you command us? Command, not what do you suggest for us. Any Muslim will say, oh, my messenger commanded me something. I'm not going to use anything other than that. The Prophet said, تُؤَدُّونَ الْحَقَّ الَّذِي عَلَيْكُمْ, you're going to fulfill the rights that are upon you. وَتَسْأَلُونَ اللَّهَ الَّذِي لَكُمْ, you're right to ask Allah for it. Wallahi, the person who uses vulgar languages, says bootlicking or things like that, has to remember consciously that last sentence is all that the manhaj of Ahlul Sunnah is. تُؤَدُّونَ الْحَقَّ الَّذِي عَلَيْكُمْ, fulfill your responsibility, what's upon you. وَتَسْأَلُونَ اللَّهَ الَّذِي لَكُمْ, and the one that is upon you, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it. In this hadith, the Prophet said, that's what he's commanded them. Usayd ibn Hudayrin, Bukhari and Muslim both narrated, the Prophet specifically said to the companions, what? فَاصْبِرُوا, be patient. حَتَّى تَلْقَوْنِي عَلَى الْحَوْضِ, until you meet me at the hawd. Bukhari Muslim both narrated it. من حديث ابن عباس رضي الله تعالى عنهما, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, من رأى من أميره شيئا يكرهه, anyone who sees, شاهد, he didn't say anyone who hears. The رؤية, he has رؤية بالبصر, it's with the eyes.
Okay.
I saw on YouTube, there was a video like that. No, you saw in front of you something he did. يكرهه, that you disliked, something منكر you saw him. The Prophet, what did he say? فليصبر, be patient. فَإِنَّهُ مَنْ فَارَقَ الْجَمَاعَ, anyone who cuts from the jama'ah, shibran, this is shibr. Shibr is from this finger, the tip of this finger, to the tip of this finger. Shahid, is that a lot?
No, not so.
That little, if you go out of the jama'ah, فَمَاتَ, you die, إِلَّا مَاتَ مِيتَةً جَاهِلِيَّةً, your death is the death of a jahiliyyah. And Imam al-Nawi said something about the previous hadith that I mentioned, hadith that Shaykhan narrated, Bukhari Muslim, hadith Anas ibn Malik. Nawi said something very powerful. He said, when he spoke about إِنَّكُمْ سَتَلْقَوْنَ بَعْدِ أَثَارَةً وَأُمُورًا تُنْكِرُونَهَا, the Prophet told the Sahabas, you're going to see things that are going to favoritism and oppression and wrongdoing, you're going to see it. Now we said, هَذَا مِنْ مُعْجِزَاتِ النُّبُوَّةِ, this is the indication of the Prophet's mu'jiza. وَقَدْ وَقَعَ الْأَخْبَارُ مُتَكَرِّرًا, he said this has happened repetition, right, one after the other. وَوُجِدَ مَخْبَرُهُ مُتَكَرِّرًا وَفِي الْحَدِيثِ, and in this hadith is what? الْحَثُّ عَلَى السَّمْعِ وَالطَّاعَةِ, urging us to listen and obey. وَإِنْ كَانَ الْمُتَوَلِّي ظَالِمًا عَصُوفًا, even if the one who's in power and is running the affairs is a what? مُتَوَلِّي ظَالِمًا عَصُوفًا, he's a tyrannical individual. فَيُعْطِي حَقَّهُ مِنَ الطَّاعَةِ وَلَا يُخْرَجُ عَلَيْهِ, what do you do? You give him your rights that are upon you and you don't go against him. وَلَا يُخْلَعُ بَلْ يُتَضَرَّعُ إِلَى اللَّهِ, but rather what do you do? You humble yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فِي كَشْفِ أَذَاهُ, to remove this harm from you, this individual. وَدَفْعِ شَرِّهِ وَإِصْلَاحِهِ, you ask Allah, oh Allah, what have we done to deserve a situation like this? You cry to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You humble yourself to Allah for him to remove this problem from you. وَدَفْعِ شَرِّهِ, and that Allah repels his harm from you subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِصْلَاحِهِ, and that Allah perfects the situation. And Imam al-Nawawi mentions this in his kitab, شرح الصحيح مسلم. He mentions in Rahimah al-Kitab al-Imara, the 12th volume, page 230, Athari rahimahullah.
And he specifically mentioned yukhraj, the word where khuruj comes from.
Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyya, look what he said about this same hadith. إِنَّكُمْ سَتَرَوْنَ بَعْدِ أَثَرَةً وَأُمُورًا تُنْكِرُونَهَا. Hadith ibn Sa'ud sahihain. Ibn Taymiyyah, he said in this hadith, he said, فَقَدْ أَخْبَرَ النَّبِيُّ, the Prophet told us, أَنَّ الْأُمَرَاءَ يَظْلِمُونَ, that the leaders are going to press, وَيَفْعَلُونَ أُمُورًا مُنْكَرَةً, they're going to do wrong things. وَمَعَ هَذَا, with that being said, فَأَمَرَنَا, and he commanded us, أَنْ نُؤْتِيَهُمُ الْحَقَّ الَّذِي لَهُمْ, that we bring them their rights that they have upon us. وَنَسْأَلُ اللَّهَ, and we ask Allah, الْحَقَّ الَّذِي لَنَا, we ask Allah the rights that are for us. وَلَمْ يَأْذَنْ, he did not allow us, في أخذ الحق بالقتال, to get our rights from him by fighting him. وَلَمْ يُرَخِّثْ, and he didn't even allow us, صلى الله عليه وسلم, في ترك الحق الذي لهم, that we say we're not going to give you your rights because you didn't give us our rights. Ibn Taymiyyah then brings the evidences to support that. رحمه رحمة واسعة. He said that in his مجموع الفتاوى رحمه الله رحمة واسعة. Let me mention these two sahabis that I said that if a person leaves this, then they're not considered from Ahlul Sunnah anymore.
Okay.
These two sahabas are very big. Hudhayfah ibn Yaman and Abu Mas'ud al-Ansari. Ibn Abi Shayba narrated in his 7th volume, page 453 to 465, عن أبي صالح الحرفي. He said, جاء رجل, a man came to إلى حذيفة وإلى أبي مسعود الأنصاري وهما جالسان في المسجد. They were both sitting in the masjid. A man came to them. وقد طرد أهل الكوفة سعد بن العاص. And the people of Kufa, they threw out سعد سعيد بن العاص. They threw him out. And then they said, فقال ما يحبسكم وقد خرج الناس. So they said to Hudhayfa and Abi Mas'ud al-Ansari, what is imprisoning you both? What's stopping you both? And the people have now done khuruj. فَوَاللَّهِ إِنَّا لَعَلَى السُّنَّةِ. Look what they said. فَوَاللَّهِ, by Allah, إِنَّا لَعَلَى السُّنَّةِ. Wallahi, we are upon the sunnah. فَقَالَ, sorry, the man said, إِنَّا لَعَلَى السُّنَّةِ. We are upon the sunnah. By going up and uprising. Because Sa'id ibn al-As is being... فقال, they both said, وكيف تكونون على السنة وقد طردتم إمامكم. How are you guys going to do, how are you guys upon the sunnah when you guys are the one who threw out Sa'id ibn al-As, your leader? والله لا تكونون على السنة, والله you're not upon the sunnah, حتى يشفق الراعي وتنصح الرعية. والله you're not going to be upon the sunnah unless you are kind and gentle to what, الراعي, the one in charge, وتنصح الرعية, and you advise the people. فقال له الرجل, the man said, فإن لم يشفق الراعي, what about if the leader is not going to be gentle to us, وتنصح الرعية, and sincere advice to the people, فما تأمر, what do you command us? They said, نخرج, we leave, وندعهم, and we just leave, we walk away and we go.
نخرج, we just leave.
Yeah, we just leave.
It's not to make خروج.
No, we don't. وندعهم, يعني it explains it after. نخرج وندعهم, we leave and we let them be. So this statement of them, which is, how are you upon the sunnah? And you're not upon the sunnah by doing this. This is not keeping you on the sunnah. Nafi' mentions, he says, Abdullah ibn Umar came to Abdullah ibn Muti' when he heard about the issue of Harra, and they took their bay'ah back from Yazid. So when he entered upon Abdullah ibn Muti', Abdullah ibn Muti' said to the people around, he said, اطرحوا لي أبي عبد الرحمن وسادة, bring a pillow for Abdullah ibn Umar. He said to him, إني لم آتيك لأجلس, I never came to sit down. Abdullah ibn Umar is saying this, I didn't come to sit down. أتيتك لأحدثك, I came to tell you something. حديثا سمعت, in which I heard رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم saying. So the Prophet died. So at the time of, he was advising Ibn Zubayr and Husayn, he knew the hadith because he already heard it from the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. So it's like something he found.
It's not
out.
He heard from another companion. He heard.
No, he heard. سمعت,
okay.
I said.
Yeah.
رسول الله, I heard the
so
Prophet
he already
صلى الله عليه وسلم
knew the hadith
saying.
At the time. Yeah, nice. Okay.
Yeah, I heard the hadith from the Prophet. What was the hadith he heard? He said, I heard the Prophet say, من خلع يدا من طاعة, the one who takes back a hand of obedience that he gave, لقي الله يوم القيامة لا حجة له, that person will meet Allah the day of judgment, there is no حجة for him. ومن مات, and anyone who dies, وليس في عنقه بيعة مات ميتة جاهلية, that person will die the death of جاهلية. سويد بن غفلة, I mentioned the statement of Umar. سويد بن غفلة, what did he do? He mentions that قال لي عمر, he said, Umar said to me, يا أمي, يا أبي, يا عمر said to him, يا أبا أمية, إني لا أدري لعلي لا ألقاك بعد عامي هذا, I'm scared and I'm worried and I think that I may not be able to meet you after this year. Then look what the advice he gave him. He said, فاسمع وأطع وإن أمر عليك عبد حبشي مجدع إن ضربك فاصبر وإن حرمك فاصبر وإن أراد أمرا ينتقص دينك فقل سمع وطاعة. And then added, he added, وَدَمِي دُونَ دِينِي فَلَا تُفَارِقِ الْجَمَاعَ. He said, if you're placed above you, an Abyssinian, يعني amputated leader, he's blind, dumb, he's amputated. And then again, he's an Abyssinian, because these people are Arabs, they wouldn't have liked that. Mm-hmm. Not that the Prophet's saying that Abyssinian leader is, he's not saying anything negative about them, yeah. But he's talking to a people who wouldn't accept that.
Sure.
He said, accept that, why not? إِنْ ضَرَبَكَ فَصْبِرْ. If he lashes you, be patient. If he prevents from you your rights, be patient. Even if he wants to do something that's going to cause harm to your religion, say to him, I hear and I obey you, but my religion in this issue, I'm not going to let you do anything to my religion. In this particular issue, I'm not going to obey you in this issue. And then look what he said after that, فَلَا تُفَارِقِ الْجَمَاعَ. Don't cut away from. So this Husayn and Umar. Umar is more knowledgeable than Husayn, more senior than him, more virtuous than him. رضي الله تعالى عنه. سماك بن الوليد, he mentions الحنفي أنه لقي ابن عمر بالمدينة. سماك بن الوليد الحنفي, he said أنه لقي ابن عباس بالمدينة. He met ابن عباس المدينة, يعني عبد الله بن عباس. فقال, he said to him, ما يقول في سلطان علينا يظلمونا. What about a leader who's oppressing us? ويشتمونا, he's insulting us. ويعتدون علينا, and they are transgressing and exceeding the limits regarding us. What should we do in a situation like that? Should we not stop them? He said, أَلَا نَمْنَعْهُمْ. Should we not stop these people? Abdullah ibn Abbas said to him, لا, no. أعطيهم يا حنفي. حنفي, just give them their wealth, what they ask you for. Until he said to him, يا حنفي, الجماعة الجماعة. The unity of the Muslims and the leader. إنما هلكت الأمم الخالية. The previous nations that came before you, they got destroyed بتفرقها, when they disunited. أما سمعت, did you not hear قول الله تعالى, the statement of Allah, واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا ولا تفرقوا. And it's funny because a lot of these people, they call to unity. They call to unity unrestrictedly, unity, unity, let's unite. But when we come with this, the leader, don't go against him, it's gonna, Khuruj is allowed.
Yeah.
Zayd ibn Hubaysh, he said, لما أنكر الناس سيرة الوليد بن عقبة ابن أبي معيط فزع الناس إلى عبد الله بن مسعود فقال لهم عبد الله بن مسعود. He said, يعني زير بن حبيش, he's saying, when the people were not happy with الوليد بن عقبة and what he was doing, الوليد بن عقبة ابن أبي معيط, they were not pleased with him, and the people, they all ran to عبد الله بن مسعود. عبد الله بن مسعود said to them, اصبروا, be patient, فإن جور إمام خمسين عاما, a leader for 50 years, خير من هرج شهر, it is better than the bloodshed of 1 month. And this hadith, al-Imam al-Tabarani narrated in his Mu'jam al-Kabir, Ibn Asakir in his Tariq, and al-Iraqi authenticated it in his Takhrij al-Hadithi al-Ihya. And he said, al-Iraqi, he said, رواه الطبراني في الكبير بإسناد لا بأس به. Anas ibn Malik, Husayn رضي الله عنه, where Anas said, نهانا كبراؤنا, our seniors, they prohibited us from what? من أصحاب رسول الله. That's why I'm saying there's إجماع amongst the Sahabas. From what? They said, لا تسبوا أمراءكم ولا تغشوهم ولا تعصوهم واتقوا الله واصبروا فإن الأمر قريب. Anas ibn Malik is saying this is advice that was given to us by who? By our seniors.
And he himself is a companion, right?
He's a companion.
Yeah, and he's saying our seniors.
Ibn Abi Asim narrated this in his Sunnah, the second volume, page 488. And Sheikh Al-Albani rahimahullah authenticated it in that kitab, Dhilal al-Jannah. He has a kitab on it. He authenticated it. Rahimahullah, Sheikh Al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala. So he's saying, لا تصبوا أمراءكم, don't insult your leaders. And as he's saying that our seniors, this is what they said to us. ولا تغشوم, don't deceive them. ولا تعصوم, don't disobey them. واتقوا الله فير الله and واصبروا. Be patient regarding their affairs. فإن الأمر قريب. So these are the senior Sahabas who spoke about this issue.
I think for me that I just want to remind the Muslims that are watching this and listening to this, that we take our religion from the Quran, the Sunnah, and the Ijma'. And this particular issue, you brought dalil, many adillah from the Quran, from the Sunnah, and within the Sunnah, it's not just random books from the Sunnah, it's Bukhari and Muslim, predominantly the Sahih of Imam Muslim, which is the second most authentic book after Imam Bukhari in terms of the books of Ahadith. So you have the Quran, you have the Sunnah, and you have an Ijma'. And ijma' you brought forward, and of course you previously in the discussion you spoke about the proofs for why ijma' is binding upon us, and you mentioned 33 names, I believe, from them: Imam Bukhari, Imam Ahmad, Ibn Taymiyyah, Imam Nawawi. These are big household names that people have heard of many, many times. Even the layman Muslims have heard of these names. And these imams did not transmit the view that you should not do khuruj. Rather, they transmitted a consensus saying that it's unanimously agreed by the scholars that you do not do khuruj. For someone to hear this and for it to be broken down like this, to still cling on to a difference of opinion, I'm struggling to find excuses for them. And to be honest with you, it doesn't surprise me, because I think we live in a time where people are claiming that making dua to other than Allah, it's not shirk. There's a difference of opinion whether it's shirk or just haram. And you know, you have difference of opinion in music and all of these issues. And I believe this issue of khuruj goes into the same bucket as all of these issues. To claim a difference of opinion on this when you've got Quran, Sunnah, ijma' of the companions and ijma' of the scholars that came after as well, I don't understand how that's possible. What I have seen from the other side, and like I said, I did a lot of research into the other side in preparation for this podcast. What I have seen is misunderstanding a fundamental issue and building an argument on top of that. For example, when we looked at Husayn and Ibn Zubair, misunderstanding that they're part of Ahlul Khali wal Aqd, misunderstanding that the Khilaf of Yazid was not complete Khilaf over all the lands, misunderstanding all of these issues and then building a lengthy argument based on that misunderstanding. And as I said before, I genuinely don't believe, and bi'idhnillah, from my khusnadhan, I don't believe that it's something that's done intentionally. There are things that I've seen that have worried me, but as a whole, I don't believe it's done intentionally. I just genuinely believe it's done through ignorance. But as we said before, whether it's done through ignorance or intentionally, they're both as bad as each other. And the end result is going to be the same. If you listen to these people, you're going to get misguided. Whether they're intentionally misguiding you or whether they're accidentally misguiding you, it's going to be the same end result for you. So I think that's the other thing that I've seen from the other side, really, is quoting books, no Quran, no Sunnah, or barely any Sunnah, quoting books. And even these books, it shocked me. I'll be honest with you, it honestly shocked me, because I didn't know what you're going to say today on the podcast. It shocked me when you bought ijma' from Imam Nawawi. It shocked me when you bought ijma' from Harb al-Kirmani. Ibn Abdul Barr, was that in your names, ijma'? It shocked me, because these are the same people that these guys, the research that I did, they're mentioning these people's books and they're taking their statements. And to take a statement from these books to try and prove a khilaf from the imam who transmitted an ijma', again, deception, I'm not going to say that, but ignorance for sure. It's just, it's worrying times we live in, which is why we decided that this issue needs to be dealt with properly. And we've spent a long time now, and it's the first time in one video that people can see every single thing related to this issue, both sides of the argument. And you've not just given one response to most questions I've asked, to be fair. You've given 3-4 different responses. And the reason why we did that is because we wanted to cover everything. We wanted to take all of their statements, bring it to the table, and respond to them. And I don't think that this requires any more from us, unless the other side or someone else brings a response for everything you've said today on this podcast. All the ijma'at that you've brought, the Quran, the Sunnah, the responses, the different answers that you've given. Every statement of yours, just like we responded to every statement of theirs, if every statement of yours is responded to, then I think it's worth us having another look and seeing what they've got to say. But until that happens, I don't think it's worth us doing anything more. And for the genuine people out there who might still have questions, I'm happy to share our email address. As long as the condition is you've watched the podcast all the way through from beginning to end, if you still have questions, you can email us at questions@amau.org. And the final piece of advice is for those people at home, people who genuinely want to know the truth. This is the video that lays it all out for you. Now it's upon you to seek beneficial knowledge, because doubts are always going to come from different people. But if you knew what an ijma' is, for example, and you knew how heavy that is in the religion, as soon as you hear an ijma' from Imam Bukhari, for example, it doesn't matter what doubts are going to come to you. It just doesn't make sense to me. It doesn't make sense to me, because Imam Bukhari could not transmit an ijma' if these many doubts existed. But when you don't have a foundation in your knowledge, what happens is you tend to go right, left, go with the wind. And that's a huge problem. So my recommendation to myself, first and foremost, before anybody else watching, is to focus on seeking beneficial knowledge, because we live in a in a time where things are a little bit crazy, in all honesty. Very, very crazy, especially when you look online. And that was another thing that I did as part of my research. I don't have a Twitter account, but I actually looked online, and for the first time I actually read through Twitter and read some of these tweets, and it really shocked me. It really, really shocked me, some of the statements that are being said, some of the misguidance that's being portrayed out there, and even some of the kind of language and the terms are being used. And my final advice is for people to fear Allah, what they say online. Just like you do, you're going to be held accountable for what comes out of your mouth. You're also going to be held accountable for what comes from your thumbs when you're typing online. And it's very dangerous to say a statement to one person, let alone on Twitter, and then it gets retweeted and shared and thousands of people view that same statement. So that's kind of how I'd like to summarize it. I don't know if you want to add anything on top of that. If not, we'll close this very, very lengthy podcast. The last thing I'd say on behalf of the people, Jazakallah khairan for your time. I've mentioned it during the podcast that it takes 2 seconds to vomit, but it takes an hour to clean up the mess. Mm-hmm. And that's what we've had to do. And it's really been you who's been there.
No, you, mashallah, Jazakallah khairan, no, for collecting all the shubhas.
So I think time you put into this, not behind the scenes research, and also bringing it to the end. Obviously, I don't know how you've done the talking, because my mouth is dry and I've not done like half the talking that you've done. So on behalf of the people, we want to thank you. We want to thank you always for the bi'idhnillah, with the permission of Allah, helping the ummah.
I think honestly, you and other brothers working behind the scenes, who are recording, who are editing, who are putting it together, it's a joint effort.
There's no doubt it's a team effort. No doubt about that. But there's a special thanks that goes out to you on behalf of the people. So I'm going to keep that there, inshallah. Without any further ado, we'll close the podcast. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.